They are underground, everywhere. But if you really want some good information, I tell you, go to South America. South America. In South America is Mr. Sauder.
Sauder.
Richard Sauder.
Richard.
You know the man?
No, I think I've seen the name, but I should contact him. Is that correct?
Yes, you can contact him.
Okay.
Mr. Sauder was has left the Americas because the government is on his ass.
Hello? 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 Is anybody there?
Oh, hello. I'm sorry. I called you,
yeah.
Didn't I?
Yes, sir. You called me. Who are you, and what would you like?
I beg your pardon, sir. My name is Woodward. I'm with CN. I was with CN News. Swami sent me.
Swami, that's a name I haven't heard in some time.
It's like a magic word I'm finding. Thank you.
Yes. What is your concern?
Swami told me to tell you that I am the journalist who was given the piece, the mini particle accelerator from CERN. That is me. I am indeed that person, and he said that I could give you a quick call to find out something. So they got a little something in there. What is that?
Science.
Okay. What happened is someone took this device from me and put it in the bottom of a lake. And he has been getting all sorts of messages, I'm told, through the intel to go out to the lake and put something else back in there. And he has been contacted by someone in Washington, and the heat is on him and me. And before I get farther into this mess, can you tell me if these underground bases are real and what else is going on behind the scenes here?
Well, that's a very deep topic.
Yes. Anything you can tell me would be a great help, sir.
Well, what I'm wanting to know is, first of all, can you give me some feedback on why Swami directed you to contact me, and how this device that you say you have fits in with this underground scenario that you're alluding to?
Well, all I know is I came home one day and I happened to have a friend who is a press relations director at CERN, and he apparently went off the deep end, they say, and began taking pieces of it and farming them out to friends, and I happened to be one of them. They came after me and beat me up and took it from me. I don't have it, and I know we're being monitored right now, and I hope this conversation lasts, but before I go find a way to get to the lake and try to find a way to find out what's down there, I just want to find out if these things are real, because this information is very new to me, and I see your name a lot, and I just don't have the time to do the research I normally would. Are these things real?
Well, let me tell you a couple of things to start out with. I am not an insider. And in your case, and in my case, that's a good thing. It means that I am not constrained by any type of security clearance or security oath, national security oath that I've taken. I've never worked for any of these so-called agencies. So that means what I know has come through conversation, archival research, observation, and direct investigation, on-site investigation. It also means that because I am not in a compartmentalized national security box, if you will, that I do not have to confine myself or my inquiry to a narrow scope. It also means I'm free to speak to a very wide variety of people, and I have. Now, all of which has left me open to discover a wide variety of information that otherwise might not have, including and especially if I were under the control of one or more of these agencies, be they publicly known or publicly unknown. The other thing is that in your opening, you might say, preamble to your question to me, you raised a number of interesting points that come up again and again in this business of underground bases. For example, let's call it purloined technology or exotic technology that is out of the ordinary realm. Your story rings a bell with me. It's not the first time I've heard it. One way or another, there are a wide variety of people on this planet who have gotten their hands on so-called exotic technology. Sometimes they want to have it. Sometimes they have gone looking for this technology. Other times the technology has just, so to speak, dropped into their hands, as is the case with you. The technology can be exotic technology of terrestrial manufacture, pure and simple, from soup to nuts. It can be so-called terrestrial technology that has been reverse engineered, and that may have come from more exotic sources, including off the planet, or it may be technology that has come from off the planet, pure and simple, has never been reverse engineered, may even be quite ancient. It may be extraterrestrial technology that has come from the moon or from Mars or other destinations in the solar system, and that has been brought back by one or more space probes or one or more space expeditions, publicly acknowledged or not, and may have, so to speak, gone wild by one means or another. So the fact that you have got some unusual technology in your hands and don't know what to do with it doesn't mean that that is unheard of or that I have never heard of that. In fact, I've spoken with others of whom that is true.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Hello? I'm still here. I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Science news, alternative history, suppressed views and opinions, activism and esoterica are all here on Deprogrammed Radio. Hello, Richard Sauder. Welcome to Deprogrammed Radio. How are you today?
I'm doing very well, thank you. How are you?
May I ask, personally, how are your feet? Are you able to walk around after what you've recently been through?
Well, you know, I still have problems with my feet and ankles. I don't have full feeling yet. I have more feeling than I did. I still have some impairment. My recuperation has now started into the third year. I am able to walk without crutches, albeit a little clumsily, but I do have, I would say, 50% function in my feet and ankles as compared to almost 99.something% non-function. Wow. As of this date 2 years ago. So I've come back a long way, and I think if I continue with my very intelligent diet and a lot of walking and physical activity, going to the gym and so forth, that I will substantially come back, I hope, to 100% of normal, and maybe even with more strength and functionality than before, because I'm paying a lot of attention to my feet and diet.
Excellent. That is good to hear. Everyone who's listening, we have this interview on Deprogrammed Radio. If you look at John Tudor's mothership,
He is the wizard who made all those little boxes with all the different programs. If you look up at the top right, you'll see an area that says links. You will see the deprogrammed.blogspot.com link there. This will have some reference material for Dr. Sauder, which is what we'll be going over today. And also, if you go to our YouTube channel and Vimeo, you will see the edited versions, which I will do and put up there as soon as it's done. Also, to explain the first part, which you saw, that is a piece from a film I am putting together called The Lake Drain. And the catchphrase is that, how do you bring up the truth? So that is in the process, a very interesting film. And that's what that first piece was. So, if you go to the blog spot and review that, you will have a better understanding of what Dr. Sauder will be going through. The first is a nice picture that I'll ask him about in a second. And if you scroll down, you will see Battlestar Galactica, The Age of Eurus. You will see his books. More importantly, you will see listed with links to his books. I encourage you to buy those books, to check them out, because I have, and you've found you have to study the information. There's a lot of actual evidence that he has collected, not just a reference to a meme or something like that that we all believe is real. So you can also see a wonderful lecture, and we also encourage you to listen to Mel Fabregas' excellent show, as well as Henrik Palmgren's show, Red Ice Creations. We aren't in it for the ratings here, we're in it for the information. So, let me ask you, first of all, here with this picture, my favorite picture, those must be, are those turkey feathers you have at the site there on your head? Are those actual turkey feathers in your cap? I remember reading about
that. Yes, yes.
I think they're beautiful.
Well, thank you. Those the compliment goes to the turkey who was shot by some anonymous hunter, undoubtedly. Those are turkey feathers, and the headdress took a number of months to make. It just evolved. It came to me to make that. I'm not Native American. I don't claim any, not one drop of Native American ancestry. But I did nonetheless make a Native American style headdress. And also there are 14 large quartz crystals from various origins around the world that I put on the lower part of the headdress. They came from Brazil, from New York, from Europe, from Arkansas, from different places around the world. And also in the necklaces that I'm wearing, there are crystals and semi-precious stones, literally from all over the planet, from several different continents. It took me a while to organize all that and put it together, and I wore that headdress when I went to the nuclear missile silo, H-8 in military parlance, silo Hero 8, just outside of Parshall, North Dakota, at the intersection of 77th Street and 33rd Avenue out in the country. And I went over the fence onto the nuclear missile silo. I was arrested and jailed. I spent 100 days in jail in North Dakota in 2010. I felt it was an important statement to make. It was a nonviolent peace protest against preparations for nuclear warfare. It's the fourth time that I've done that in my life, quite likely the last time, because I've subsequently relocated to South America, where, thank God, to my knowledge, in the country where I am, there are no nuclear missiles, as far as I know. And I'm happy to live in a country that isn't attacking country after country after country and ceaselessly plotting how to cause mayhem on the international stage. Now, with regard to nuclear war, there's a very real possibility of nuclear war, and if the United States and Europe especially continue the bellicose foreign policy that they have established against Russia in particular. Every month that goes by, the odds of nuclear war increase. This push towards war is coming from the United States and NATO, and it is it's more than insane. It is deeply wicked.
And it is an agenda, is it not?
It's a foul agenda. And it cannot possibly result in any good outcome for anyone, including the NATO countries or the United States itself. I perceive it as coming essentially from a satanic level of reality.
Yes, indeed. Folks, may I remind you that in this area of research, away from the mainstream news, people, in my view, who don't do the research on something use the phrase out there, which means to me that they really haven't looked into the situation. And I personally do not use the two words together, conspiracy and theory. I think that is loaded in to keep a mask over the situation. So we're not going to be politically correct here. And I'm talking with a gentleman who has the guts to do something that perhaps you've never done and I've never done. So let's give due to that reality, if we may. Let me ask you about that. When I first heard the details from something you'd read about that, what did you feel like when you got on top of that thing and they started coming for you? What did you feel like at that moment?
Well, you see, first you go over the fence. And the reality we're raised with is that, the false reality we're raised with is that everything is secure. Nothing can go wrong. The national security apparatus has everything under control. And that's simply not so. The first thing you notice is how easy it is to drive right up to a nuclear missile silo and climb over the fence. There's no one there, and there's no one to stop you, and there are hundreds of these things. And then the second thing you notice, and I've done this repeatedly during my lifetime, and I've been repeatedly jailed for it. The second thing you notice is that you have to wait for the military security detail to show up and arrest you because they don't even know that you're there. You're there standing on top of one of their nuclear missiles, and they don't even know. So unless you walk in range of one of their motion sensors or cameras, which do not have comprehensive coverage of the silo area, you could sit down there and have a picnic lunch and maybe be there for an hour or three before anyone noticed you were there. So that's the second thing. The nuclear security in the United States is extremely lax. Let's say more than lax, it is relaxed. And then the third thing is that once they do come for you, it's not with massive force initially. Usually there will be a military jeep that'll drive by. It won't stop. It'll just drive by. They're just looking to see what's going on. The second thing that happens is a sniper will come out and take up a position 100 yards, 150 yards away, and draw a bead on your head. And that'll take anywhere from half an hour to 45 minutes for that to happen. And then another jeep or two will show up. And in my case, at North Dakota, after all of that happened, I'd been there the better part of an hour when I could hear multiple helicopters coming, thump, 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 miles away. And I immediately knew that they had, assault squads in the helicopters coming for me. So then they came in real fast and real low and sat down. I mean, just the rotors were 180 degrees to the ground. They came in fast and made some bizarre Hollywood movie style landings. They had some real cowboy pilots in those helicopters. And they sat down behind a nearby knoll and disgorged guys in, you know, with vests and helmets and automatic rifles and all that kind of stuff. And eventually they sent one of those squads for one unarmed protester. They ramped up the security over the period of an hour or more. And eventually they had about 40 armed police and military personnel roaming around the silo area and military helicopters buzzing around like bumblebees. And then they cut the lock on the gate with the bolt
cut
cutters.
Cut the lock? They didn't have the keys?
No, I don't think they had a key. and then they came in. The guys from the helicopters, I don't think, had the key. Then they came in, and of course, they come in with automatic rifles pointing at you, and they clomp, clomp, clomp right up to you, and they say, hands in the air. On your knees. Stand up. On your knees. Turn around. On your knees. Stand up. On your knees. And then they tell me to get on the ground. So I just flopped forward on my nose onto the ground. And like a sack of potatoes, I didn't do anything. He told me to get on the ground. I didn't say, but you know, I'm going to break my face. I just went over, straight over, flat on. Straight over on the ground.
And you were bleeding profusely at this point, right?
Well, from my hands, from climbing over the fence, the barbed wire.
Cut
my hands.
Right.
Yes. And so I was, I bled a lot on the silo, but they took so long for them to get there.
I bet they liked that, right?
Well, no, they weren't sadistic. They were just very matter-of-fact. The military were heavily armed, and matter-of-fact, I didn't resist them in any way. I did everything they told me to do immediately. I didn't give them any lip. When you have a bunch of guys pointing automatic rifles right at you with the safeties off, I'm not going to argue with them.
Indeed.
So then they handcuffed me and turned me over to the county sheriff. And the county sheriff's deputy took me to jail. I was put in jail, and I didn't leave jail until the trial, which was 100 days later.
That's remarkable.
I do not have the headdress that was taken from me by one of the county sheriff's deputies, and I never recovered any of my property. So, you know, the police agencies confiscate a lot of property from people, and it's just the reality. If you're arrested, they will probably take property from you. If you're lucky, they won't take much. If you're unlucky, they'll take every last penny you have.
How long after that did you move out of the United States?
Well, I was released from jail the last week of January 2010, and of July, rather. And the first day of November, I left the United States. So that was about just a little over 3 months later, I left the United States, and I have not returned. I intend to remain in South America.
You went down to South America and you set up residence there, and you experimented, researched ayahuasca, got involved with a shaman. And could you update us on what happened around that point?
Well, I have drunk a lot of ayahuasca. I have drunk a lot of malakawa as well. That's a native word. I'm not sure if it's Quechua or Shuara or both. Malakawa was simply one of the plants that a lot of shamans in South America use. Not all of them, but a lot of them do. And there are other plants there. There's a whole list of so-called entheogenic plants or psychotropic plants that native South American shamans live. Just a few of them would be yopo, ayahuasca, malakawa, San Pedro. Those are just four from off the top of my head, and there are more.
And these are often mixed with other vines. Is that correct? It's not always
No, there's different ways of preparing these. There are different ways of preparing these. In fact, there's more than one way to prepare ayahuasca. There are a variety of ways to prepare ayahuasca. In fact, there are over 24 different varieties of the ayahuasca vine.
I see.
So all of this, you would, to know it well, you would have to learn over a period of years and actually to apprentice with someone. It's not something you go down to South America and learn all about in a weekend seminar. And I know that weekend seminars are very big in the United States, and there are a lot of people who think, well, if you go away for a one-week intensive, you're going to learn something really well. That's fallacious. In a one-week intensive, you will learn a little bit, and that's all. To really learn anything well, whether it's South American shamanism, or physics, or chemistry, or whatever, requires a period of concentrated study of years, usually many years. If you want to learn to play the saxophone really well, you're going to have to apply yourself for years. It's just the way it is. Mm-hmm. Your profession is acting. In order to master your craft, you've had to work at it over a period of years. Anything is like that, from A to Z. And shamanism is the same way. And people who imagine that they will come down to South America and they'll drink ayahuasca a few times and they'll understand ayahuasca and they'll understand South American shamanism, they're just deluding themselves. It's not so. You really have to immerse yourself in it over a period of years and give yourself over to the process. And so, though I have drunk a lot of ayahuasca, I have drunk a lot of malekawa, I lived with a man and learned something from him in a year's time, I would certainly not call myself a shaman or claim that I know everything about ayahuasca or malekawa. I don't. I've learned something. I know something. But it's a process of years and years, and I've just begun that process.
So we now have you studying it, and there's revelations which are going to lead into the last part of this with what we're living in this reality. In the along the way, you need a mentor, correct? And is this the shaman that you lived with? Was he your mentor?
No. It turns out in the end that he was my tormentor.
Yes, indeed. That's what I was leading to. Yeah. So
he, in the end, my last days with him, he almost killed me, and ultimately, after more than a year, I pushed a case through the justice system, so-called justice system in Ecuador, and ultimately there was a trial. But like most trials, most everywhere on this planet, it was a charade. Usually most trials in this world we're living in are just it's some kind of mockery of justice. And ultimately, the government of Ecuador doesn't want to rock the boat because there's a lot of Amazonian tourism. And Amazonian tourism brings not just millions, but ultimately billions of dollars directly and indirectly into the economy of Ecuador and other countries in South America. So if they start having public trials where Amazonian shamans are criminally convicted of assaulting the gringos, well, that doesn't look very good for the tourist industry. And a lot of people come down and they visit shamans and they go and take tours in the Amazon, etc. So when you go up against these guys, you're really going up, indirectly, you're going up against a multi-billion dollar tourist industry.
Is it that much already, really?
Oh, and South America as a whole, certainly, and even in Ecuador.
Oh, my goodness.
The three biggest industries, legal industries in Ecuador, are petroleum, tourism, and bananas. Of course, narcotics. Of course, narcotics have to enter into that equation, but narcotics are an illegal industry. But in the open legal economy, yeah, tourism is real big. There are just thousands and thousands of people coming here every day. Not just from the United States, but from Europe, from Australia, from China, from different places, Japan. And You figure if a tourist comes here from Europe and there are, say, I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of tourists are coming. Every day there are thousands of them. There are 365 days in a year. So easily, you probably millions of tourists are coming every year. And if each tourist on average spends $1,000, and a great many tourists spend far more than $1,000 when they go to a country for food, they buy crafts, they take tours, they stay in hotels, etc. They pay taxis, they ride the buses, on and on. And so if you've got easily a million foreign tourists coming to Ecuador a year, and if they're just spending $1,000 on average, and many of them are spending a great deal more than that, sure, it's a multi-billion dollar industry in Ecuador alone. So in a sense, if you're, you know, assaulted by a shaman, and then you go up against that, you're going up against the Ecuadorian government tourism ministry as well. They won't say so openly, but they will pass the word to the prosecutor, to the judges, to everyone involved. We want to soft pedal this case because it'll look bad for the tourism industry if we start having convictions against Amazonian shamans for killing or almost killing gringos.
Now, so, now that the case is over, can you, for the folks who want to go down there for a little recreation, can you tell us what it is he did to you?
Well, three things.
Right.
Three things. He gave me Malikawa, but he gave me not only too much more than he should have, but I suspect he gave me a poisonous variety as well. There are hundreds of varieties of Malikawa, which is in the Floripondia family, so-called angel's trumpet, it's often called. There are hundreds of varieties. The shamans only use a handful, like 1% or less of those varieties. And you have to know what you're doing. They do. So I would not recommend an outsider even touch this stuff. But it can be safely used under the tutelage of a shaman who knows what he's doing, who will take care of you and not abuse you. So I suspect not only did he give me more than he should have, but that he gave me some from one of the poisonous varieties. And then the second thing he did was he came with a syringe and injected me against my will. I saw the syringe in his hand, and I saw what he was going to do. He told me, Ricardo, I'm going to inject you. And I said, no, I don't want you to do that. And he said, oh, yes. And then he injected me. I was in no condition to do anything physically to evade the injection. And the other thing that happened was that I was beaten quite badly. I was savagely beaten. And
why would they beat you?
Well, I think to kill me, Jerry.
Yeah, sure, obviously.
I think I have a real strong will. I know I have a very strong will to live. And I believe I actually may have died one time or maybe twice and spontaneously revived. Of course, there are books out there about this, about people dying and spontaneously reviving. It's not unheard of at all.
Right.
I believe it happens a lot, and people just don't talk about it. In my case, one of the first things I remember them saying is, and I put this in the affidavit I gave to the prosecutor's office. They were walking around me. They put me under one of the houses. In that part of the Amazon, the houses are up on stilts, on poles, on pilings. And they put me under one of these houses and were walking around me. I was face down in the dirt. And one of the things that they said was, look, he's moving. He's listening to us. I suspect that was a bit of a surprise for them. They may have thought that I was dead. And so the fact that I was moving may have been their first indication that I was alive and that they hadn't killed me. So why to kill me? I could speculate on various motives, but one of the things that these plants do, or can do, and not for everyone, but for me and for others, they can show you quite a lot of information, in some cases very factual information. They also can show you actual spirits. We are surrounded by spirits, Jerry.
Yes, indeed.
The reality is that we are spirits ourselves.
Indeed.
And that we are living in a spiritual reality, a spiritual realm. Our culture tries to persuade us the opposite is true. But in fact, we are surrounded by all kinds of spirits, plant spirits, animal spirits, so-called nature spirits, butterfly spirits, bird spirits, reptile spirits, insect spirits, including human spirits.
Mm-hmm.
And when you drink these plants, and I have done it many times now, you may see other spirits. In my case, I have seen quite a lot of spirits, including extraterrestrials. We are immersed, as I said, in a spiritual reality. The foundation of reality is essentially spiritual. And so these spirits may interact with you. They may walk right up to you and interact with you. In my case, some of them certainly have. And once you become consciously, and this is part of shamanism, by the way, as you go deeper into shamanism, you interact consciously more and more with the spiritual world. And all I can say is, everyone, when they die, like it or not, will be going to and or returning to the spiritual world. So you ignore the spiritual world at your personal peril. Because
exactly.
when you die, and you find yourself in the spiritual world, doesn't matter if you believe it's real or not, the spiritual world will call itself directly to your attention in the hour of your death. Your body will die. It will not respond to you. And so there you will be, surrounded by spiritual beings in a fundamentally spiritual reality. My advice is prepare yourself in advance.
Prepare yourself.
Number one. So that you have some influence on what kind of spiritual beings you will find yourself with after you die, number one. And number two, if you go out of your way to make it your business to gain some familiarity with spiritualities, when you find yourself in a spirituality, you will not be confused. You will not ask, "Where am I? What's going on? Who are you?" You will know, number one, my body has died for whatever reason. I got sick. I had an accident. I just died from old age. I was murdered. Whatever. You will know my body is dead. I am out of my body. I am in a spirituality. That's the first important understanding to have. I am in a fundamentally spiritual reality. I have to deal with it spiritually. Not physically. Number two, I am surrounded by or confronted with or in front of or I see spiritual beings. Instead of freaking out, you have to deal with that. It's the way it is. In the spiritual realm, the beings are spiritual. You must deal with that. If you don't, you will have a very hard time in the spiritual world.
The second thing is,
the type of person you are and the type of spiritual experience you have or the type of spiritual experience you avoid will determine the type of spiritual beings with whom you interact in the spirit world. It's the way it is. In fact, you could even say it's that way in this world. The type of person you are in this world determines, for the most part, the type of people with whom you interact, even more so in the spiritual world. So my advice is, understanding that, instead of blowing me off, or instead of saying, he's crazy, he doesn't know what he's talking
out
about.
Out there.
I'm telling you, right now, as you're listening to this, whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not, whether you know it or not, you are fundamentally a spirit living a spiritual existence. You are right now in a spiritual realm, and you are surrounded right now by spirits, including human spirits.
Indeed.
And they look like people. And this is the other thing. Once you get into these other states of awareness and you see people, what kind of people have I seen? They've all been adult humans. I haven't seen children, by the way.
Or fairies.
Nor have I seen elderly beings. But all of the human beings, human spirits that I've seen, have been either no older, I would say, than their early 40s, and no younger than their early 20s, in that age range, prime of life. Male and female, I've seen Caucasians, I've seen mulattoes, I've seen mestizos, I've seen indigenous. I haven't seen Chinese or Orientals or Polynesians. Those are all the racial groupings that I have seen in the Amazon forest. Right there in the bushes.
Love it. Do you see through these people, or are they solid looking visually?
They look as solid as anyone else. So solid that I always assume without fail that they are just people passing through, going down the jungle path, just waving to me, or just decided to walk up there and lay down and sit there for a while, or just... It seems so normal, Jerry, that I just accept them as real people. And what I would say is, the same way with the extraterrestrials I saw, they were so normal seeming, just solid as can be, that I accepted, okay, there are a couple of extraterrestrials here, no big deal. They were just very casual and nonchalant, like they were just walking through and just paused for a couple of minutes to just hang around and just look at me and just enjoy the ambiance, and then went on their way. It was so casual that I didn't flip out at all. It was just like, there are a couple of extraterrestrials here, and you instantly know they're not from the Earth. They're so different. They just exude this otherworldliness. But... And then they left, and it was only later I realized it was just no big deal.
That's remarkable. Thank you for that. We're going to lead into the information that you sent me in an email. Let me read this. Now that we've set it up to where you are indeed someone who stands for something, has done something. Oh, before I get into that, where did you learn to write so well? I'm not trying to play you up here, but you are an excellent writer. Your sentence structure, your everything is... where did you learn to write like that?
Well, you know, when I was... it kind of happened. Let me put it that way. When I was young, I was painfully shy and bashful for many, many years, right up through my high school years and into my college years, into early adulthood. It's only later in life that I have become much less bashful, much less shy, to the point where I have done public speaking in front of audiences of hundreds of people, and have done numerous radio and television interviews, sometimes with audiences of literally several millions. I could not have done that when I was younger, in my teens and early 20s and right up into my early 30s. I couldn't have done it. I would have been paralyzed with fear. Similarly, with writing, although I read a lot as a child, I devoured all kinds of books. I've read hundreds, maybe thousands of books on many different topics. But even when I was younger, writing was something that was hard for me to do. I had writer's block. In fact, when I was in college, I actually flunked some courses because I couldn't write the term papers. I just couldn't do it. It just wouldn't flow. It just wouldn't come out. And I couldn't do the writing. So I flunked college courses because I couldn't do the writing.
Wow.
So it's writing, and even my first book, it just happened by accident. I had run across some documents having to do with underground bases, and I was sitting in a coffee shop in Los Angeles talking to some guys. Might have been off of Wilshire Boulevard, I'm not sure, couldn't say exactly, but it was somewhere in downtown Los Angeles. And we were sitting in like one of these 24-hour pancake houses, something like that, having breakfast. And one of the guys was, I can't tell what airline he flies for because he keeps a low profile, but he's a career airline pilot, flies big jets internationally, I mean on overseas routes. Mm-hmm. He flies for one of the big, well-known airlines. So I was showing these guys at breakfast some of the documents that my research had uncovered. And so he said to me, you need to write a book. I said, I've never written a book. He said, I understand that, but you need to write one. I said, no, I don't think so. He said, well, I do. And so that's where it ended. And we all went our separate ways. And so I went back home and put it out of my mind. And then about some weeks later, I woke up in the morning with that ringing in my mind what he had told me. You need to write a book. And so within about just a matter of weeks, I wrote the outline of my first little book, which is Underground Bases and Tunnels, What is the Government Trying to Hide? And in fact, some of the documents that I had at breakfast there in Los Angeles must have been back around 1992 or 1993, I guess it was. I included material from some of those documents in that first book. So it just happened. And it wasn't my idea. It was someone else's idea. And once I sat down to write it, I'm not claiming it's a great book. I'm just claiming it's a book that tens of thousands of people have read. And so it's the little book that could. And when I first wrote it up, it wasn't published. I didn't have a publisher. I just had a document that I ran off on a word processor. And in those days, we didn't have laser printers. We had the dot matrix printers.
Mm-hmm, right.
And I ran it off on one of those printers. And I went to a corner copy center, independent copy center. And I ran off some copies and spiral binding. And just went around trying to sell them to people, like for $5 or $10, right? And I happened to show them to a guy. I initially ran off, you know, like 10 or 15, and people bought them. So I ran off 10 more. People bought those 10. You see how it happened? It just accidental. And I was just like saying, psst, hey, buddy, I wrote this book. You want to read it? Oh, what's it about? Well, it's got underground stuff.
Right.
Oh, far out, man. So it wasn't a book. It was just this thing I ran off at a copy center, you know, 10 copies at a time. And it got up to like 200 or 250 copies. And then my brother, my younger brother, typeset it for me. He said, you know, there's some interest in this. You want me to typeset it for you? I said, okay. So my younger brother typeset it. And then he had a little independent press at that time and ran off just a 100, 200 copies, something like that. And then those sold. And then David Hatcher Childress, actually I ran into someone at a conference, a UFO conference, and showed it to them. And that person knew a guy named, whose name I won't mention, a Southern California hustler, who then bought up all the copies of the book I had and said he would make me big. My book was going to sell 100,000 copies, and he would make big money. Well, he stole from me. I won't mention the guy's name. He stole from me. And when I found out he was stealing from me, I was living in Arizona at that time. I actually drove from Arizona, from Flagstaff, and showed up at his place of business unannounced in the morning. And when he was shocked, and I confronted him, and I said, you know, you owe me money. You've been stealing from me. I got my money from him. And all of my books, I loaded my little Ford Fiesta to the roof with all the books and drove out of there with cartons of my books. And then David Hatcher Childress, who now has Adventures Unlimited Press, mm-hmm, right. It's one of the best alternative presses. Absolutely. In the world.
Yes.
David has one of the best gigs going, and he's worked hard to establish it. I wrote to David Hatcher Childress, and I said, you know, I have this book on underground bases. Would you be willing to take it over for me and sell it and print it? And he said, okay, just send me what you have, and I'll sell it for you. And because he had just written his first one or two books, published his own books. And so I sent him my book, and he sold out everything I sold, sent him, and then he printed it up. And I was David's first book. Now David has dozens, hundreds of books. I love his catalog. But I was David's first book, first author. And then he subsequently is still handling a couple of my books.
We have him linked on the Blogspot. Let me interrupt right here because I'm going to ask you the one big question, then we're going to continue over the hour. This will be on YouTube and Vimeo and wherever else, but we don't have a subscriber section, so we're not asking that big question and then go into the break. But just so folks will hear it on the radio, we're about to run out of time there. The question is, and everything is linked on the Blogspot, but this leads into your experiences with ayahuasca and everything.
O'clock.
And you said in your email to me that two levels of control, if we are on automatic, DNA, which is natural if it is not genetically engineered, and maybe it is to a degree, and number two, the machine, artificial and subtle, devious and ruthless beyond words. So that will be on Vimeo and YouTube, and if you're cutting off on the radio, we'll see you later. And what do you say to that question, sir? About the DNA in particular.
Yes.
That's a surprise. I didn't quite think of it that way before.
Well, you see, with DNA, I said earlier, we are spiritual beings. That's true. And we are spiritual beings in physical bodies in a physical universe, a 3D universe. From the standpoint of human beings on the planet Earth, in our physical bodies, the programming, the master program of our physical bodies is our DNA, our genetic code. You're born with that. Now, we now know and are developing the science and technology to modify the genetic code, not only for humans, but for all kinds of biological life forms. Presumably, if humans, terrestrial humans, now have developed that technology, it's available to any other technologically capable species of life, whether it's a natural species of life or artificial species of life, to do the same thing. There are those that say that our DNA has been modified multiple times in the past, that we may be a hybrid species ourselves, that the human genome that we presume is natural may not be natural. It may be a modified genome, not a naturally evolved genome. I am open to that discussion. Now, as far as non-biological programming, we also have other types of programming, artificial programming. Ayahuasca, in my first sessions with ayahuasca, called to my attention something that I have called the machine. The machine is appears to be extremely powerful, extremely sophisticated, artificial, and operating not only in the three-dimensional physical realm, but also in the near spiritual realm, the so-called astral realm. The machine is not all powerful, but it is considerably powerful. I do not perceive the machine as God, but I believe it may be a weapon of war that operates at least on a planetary scale, perhaps on a solar system scale, and maybe even on a galactic or subgalactic scale. The machine appears to have many tentacles and control extensions, and to use them to dominate a sentient species of life, such as the human race on planet Earth, and also to dominate and subjugate the planet itself, which includes myriad other non-human species of life, and also the atmosphere, the hydrosphere, the lithosphere, etc., the aquasphere on this planet, the ionosphere, all of it, all of the spheres, including the biosphere, and all of these aspects of the planet are related in multiple ways with thousands, if not millions and billions, of feedback loops. We see in the solar system one planet is orbiting as rubble between Jupiter and Mars. The esoteric tradition on this planet holds that that planet was inhabited many thousands of years ago and was destroyed in interplanetary warfare or galactic warfare. My guess is perhaps in the time frame of 15,000 to 75,000 years ago. We also have another planet in the solar system that's been devastated. That would be Mars. It appears that Mars was very Earth-like in the past, but underwent tremendous bombardment. And now Mars is without an atmosphere, or like less than 1% of the atmosphere it used to have. Mars apparently also used to have rivers and lakes and oceans. All of that is gone. It is a desert planet, a devastated planet at this point. I was just reading an article today on the internet. There's a lot of scientific evidence that there was a vast nuclear explosion on Mars in the past that devastated the planet. The nuclear explosion was like 1 million times as great as a 1 megaton bomb explosion. A 1 megaton nuclear explosion will take down most cities. So we're talking about something a million times more powerful than that. There may have been more than one thing. Mm-hmm. When you get into the esoteric tradition of this solar system's history, and I'll leave you on your own to do that. You can dig out bits and pieces of it here and there. It does appear that there was, shall we say, war in heaven in the distant past in the solar system. And planet-busting weaponry was brought into play. The mother of all nuclear weapons, I think plasma discharge weapons, probably scalar weapons, things of that nature were used. We are now, with terrestrial military technology, developing some of these same weapons all over again. Nuclear weapons, scalar weapons, plasma, particle beam weapons. It's like we're replaying this dark chapter of history, like we have an amnesiac block, and in the most dysfunctional way possible, we are now, after a lapse of who knows, 10, 20, 40,000 years, replaying it all over again. Like a dysfunctional, abusive family that replays the abuse generation after generation. We're sick, man. We got a real sick aspect buried deep in our psyche, deep in our genes, deep in our racial memory. We are just sick to our souls. Look around the planet, you'll see what I mean. How do we get better by any means possible? Any therapeutic means that will make anyone better, physically and spiritually, it can only help. That's all I have to say. But it appears there was interplanetary warfare. Some of it took place on the Earth, but the planet that used to orbit between Mars and Jupiter, and Mars took the brunt of it. Venus itself may have been further out in the solar system in the past, and may have been flung into the inner solar system by this violent conflict. There was heavy weaponry that was brought in, heavy, heavy stuff.
There is some evidence, if I may, there is some evidence on the internet. A gentleman I came across a while ago named Norval Cunningham, his first name is spelled N-O-R-V-A-L, he's collected a series of photographs that show catena chains on the moon, for example, where it is quite obvious that some sort of weapon has left a perfectly straight line with marks in a row. It's kind of obvious that a large piece of rock that hit a planet wouldn't make a perfectly straight line. So I've seen his collection.
No, you're looking at high-tech planet-busting machine guns there.
Yeah, unbelievable. They're on the internet. You can see them, right?
On the moon, you can see that.
Mm-hmm.
One of Mars' moons, Phobos, has just been machine-gunned up and down. I mean, we're not talking about 50 caliber. We're talking about 5 billion caliber. The military machinery that was used in this conflict was just mind-boggling. And you're right, the moon just had the hell shot out of it. Just shotgunned up, down, and sideways, as did Mars. And you just had, we're talking battle cruisers that came in here and just shot the F-U-C-K out of this solar system. There was just a huge battle for control of the solar system. My presumption is that this thing that I am calling the machine won. And now lords it over this solar system. I am presuming the machine has different aspects. It can be, in fact, the moon itself may be the place from which the machine projects, or the moon in orbit around Mars. All of that may be extensions of this machine.
The moon never turns around, does it?
No. And in fact, there are records when you go back into the deep legends and a deep history, deep written history of the Earth, there are references to the time before when the moon was not orbiting around the Earth. I don't know when the moon arrived. I'm guessing it arrived sometime within the last 100,000 years, perhaps within the last 50,000 years. It appears the moon was not always orbiting the Earth, and that when it set up orbit around the Earth, it was a big event, literally a watershed event. That may have been what caused the big flood legends all over the Earth, because you move in something huge like that, and it is tidal locked to the Earth. Any body of water, any large body of water on the Earth, it's going to just wreak havoc with that. And it'll take a period of weeks, maybe months, maybe even years, for all of the oceans and seas to settle down again. So it was a big event. And it would have been the kind of event that would have killed a lot of people outright. And those that were left would have been real traumatized. Whatever major civilization was here would have pretty well been leveled. which may have been the intent. You move in something big like that, it's evidently the moon is occupied. There's a lot of tangential evidence to indicate that, and that those who occupy it pulled rank, for example, on NASA, when NASA sent the astronauts up there. Evidently, the message was, yeah, you can send a couple of little, you know, 5 or 10 little exploratory missions up here, but that's it. You can come and visit for a day or two and then scurry back to Earth, but that's the extent of it, because we are the referee here. It's our game, and this is our little planet here. You don't come here. You stay away. That would be consistent with the clandestine record of NASA's very strange Apollo program.
Well, if you also look on the blogspot, if you're there now, or if you look at there's a Jay Widener link for another interview, which we haven't done yet. On that link, you will see some videos. One I posted up there is of the lunar module taking off from the moon that we've all seen. Well, this little clip that starts at 4 minutes shows it taking off. It's the one we've seen. And then somebody's maintained the rest of the film, and it shows it coming back down. There's also a video of the International Space Station, and clearly evidence of what looks like they've filmed the interviews of some of the scientists in one of those planes that goes up and comes down. And you'd have to look at that video to see it. I wasn't aware of that. But they're obviously former Nazis who were allowed to come in and do what they've done. The Bush family is obviously a Nazi family, or they're from Germany, and they've done what they've done to our country. And it seems as if at the moment we're under the guise of George Bush Daddy and his CIA connections leading up to what we have now. How do we get out of this or move along?
Not easily. The only way that I see out is through a massive spiritual uprising, not political, not military. Spiritual uprising. I think we've painted ourselves into a corner. We've been maneuvered into a position that, frankly, is untenable. If we do not have a global spiritual uprising, not religious uprising, Jerry, spiritual, by which I mean expansion of consciousness, a dramatic increase in awareness, a growth of consciousness, then we're toast. The days of terrestrial humanity are numbered. Because of Fukushima alone, because of the way that these nuclear reactors behave when they fail, and now we have a failed one at Chernobyl in Ukraine, and we have 3 and maybe 4 failed ones at Fukushima, and we have hundreds of others, any of which is subject to failure on any given day for any one of 100 different causes. The issue is that once these things fail, they are not repairable. You cannot send a team in to fix them. They have failed for once and for all and remain failed. But because of the way this corium behaves and these other types of substances, radioactive substances, they continue deadly for like a geological age, 250,000 years, something like that. So as these things fail, and we've already had at least 4 or maybe 5 of them fail catastrophically, and more of them will unless we get rid of them totally, then we're just done, man. It's over. The human organism cannot survive high levels of radioactivity. We just can't. And the levels keep raising, not only because of failed nuclear reactors, but because of all of the depleted uranium munitions that the United States and NATO militaries are blasting around the battlefields that they create, but also because of half a century of nuclear testing. And then the other issue is nuclear waste. These nuclear reactors and nuclear weapons production cycle produces not just thousands of tons, but no one knows how many millions of tons of nuclear waste, which you cannot dispose of. You just can't get rid of the stuff. And it's piling up all over the world, in Russia, in the United States, in France, in England, in Germany. Everywhere there are nuclear reactors. More and more of it every year, more and more of it. So we are now self-destructing. We are suiciding as a species because of our misguided nuclear technology. That, in and of itself, without anything else, is doing us in.
And so who runs these people who do this to the planet? We have Oppenheimer, who was a high-level adept, apparently. You can look in the guy's eyes and pictures and see there's something pretty dark going on, I guess, in my assessment. If he's a Satanist, he's in charge of that. What are we doing? What are they doing to the planet? Why would they do that?
Well, we're essentially in a situation where a lot of so-called human beings, not only famous ones like Oppenheimer or Edward Teller or, you know, any of these other people who develop genocidal technologies, they essentially sell their souls. Either they don't have souls or they sell them. And what do they get? They get a parking space with their name spray painted on it. They get an office with a secretary and their name, a brass nameplate on an office door. I'm telling you what people sell their souls for, man. Or they get a 401k, they get a golden parachute. Yeah. Or they get all the cocaine they can snort without fear of criminal repercussions because they're on the inside and everyone on the inside does it because they all have each other's back. I'm not telling you anything you don't know.
Right.
This is how the world works. This is certainly the way it works in Hollywood, in show business. It's the way it works in compartmentalized black world. It's the way it works in alphabet soup agencies. Or maybe you get, you know, you get a numbered Swiss bank account or an account in the Cayman Islands. You get an anonymous trust fund set up for you. You get $5,000 a night whores, whether you like boys or girls. You get a private plane flight to Epstein's secret island in the Caribbean. It's happening right now, man. Yeah. People selling their souls. Or you get a Ph.D. that you really didn't work for, but they give it to you because you're a player, because you do what they say. And then you get to call yourself Dr. Stuff and such.
Or president.
That it. Or president. You get a law degree you didn't really earn from Harvard. You're president, you know, you're editor of the Harvard Law Review, and you never write one word.
Yeah.
And that's on your resume. And you get to be president. What's the price? You just do whatever you're told.
Right.
You just say whatever you're given to say. They tell you to smile, you smile. They tell you to lay low for a couple of weeks, you lay low. They tell you to go play golf for 5 weeks in Hawaii. You go play golf for 5 weeks in Hawaii. And you fly around on a big jet and you have the mother of all security details. It happens. It's the way the system works. This is what the machine does. The machine gives you what you want. There's only one price. The machine requires of you your soul, your very soul. And ayahuasca showed me this in a sense as well. In one of the first sessions I had with ayahuasca, it showed me something like a long shed with a low roof, no more than 10 feet high, something like that. And in this shed, which stretched, I don't know, maybe to the vanishing point, a long distance, there were two rows of seats and the roof of this, under the roof, the ceiling of this shed, this long shed, was a piping system, pipes, tubing, and extending down from this tubing or this piping where each seat was a type of device that would fit on the top of a human head. And then I saw people coming in, men and women, to sit down in these seats in two long rows, stretching away to the vanishing point in the distance. And this suction-like device connected to the tubing overhead was then fastened to the top of their head, and they would be sucked off. Their vital essence, so to speak, their life stuff was sucked off. And it made them feel good. It was like looking at an opium den, like people sitting around smoking opium, like a crack house, people taking hits off crack pipe or something like that. Their eyes were just glazed, eyes in their faces were glazed with pleasure, and they were moaning with pleasure. And I saw them just having their, I don't know, their vital life juice, so to speak, sucked off, and then it was sucked off into this tubing overhead and pumped away somewhere. Very much analogous to a milk shed, like a dairy parlor on a dairy farm, where the cows come in the morning and the evening, and then they have these suction devices hooked up to the teats on their udders, and they get gallons of milk sucked out of their milk bags twice a day. And for the cows, this is pleasurable. It's like having a calf, like four calves simultaneously, sucking the milk out of their udders. And then they usually get fed something at the same time, some ensilage with some molasses and oats. So for the cow, it's a twofer. The cow's getting sucked off, and it's also getting this stuff to eat. And that's why cows willingly go into the milking parlor for the cow. And they say, feels good.
Yeah.
And this is what I saw. Only instead of the cows being milked, was people being milked to the top of their head, to their crown chakra, their vital essence. And so what does the machine do with this juice, whatever it wants? The machine, understand, is artificial, but all of a sudden it has this vital life juice, which it can use, which it can engineer. I bet that is an energy source that it can sell on open market, probably galactically. I would imagine fresh human juice, fresh Earth human juice, has a certain price on the galactic market.
The TV series Battlestar Galactica references a lot of this, what you're talking about, and I watched most of that series and got a different insight into some things. But let me,
Jerry, do you think the creative entities behind Battlestar Galactica might possibly have drunk ayahuasca once or twice?
Could be, yes. Possibly. For 10 times. I know there won't be a juice out there for ayahuasca juice. I understand that much. I understand it's pretty nasty.
Start with the fact that it tastes really bad.
Oof.
And that it's quite I'm almost vomiting just talking about it. And it's quite common to vomit when you drink it. Now there are people I've met who claim that it doesn't faze them, but let me say, this will never be Coca-Cola or Sprite or anything like that. It's not like lemonade. It's not like you go and you order a hamburger and some fries and you say and I'd like a lemonade. It's not like that, Jerry.
Wow.
It tastes so bad. And people who worry about addiction to ayahuasca, well, let me set your mind at ease. This is never anything your kids are going to get addicted to. It just won't happen. They might drink it once or twice out of curiosity, and they'll go right back to Coca-Cola. Whether or not Coca-Cola is a good thing, we could talk about later.
Yes, indeed. Let me ask you one last question, and we'll let you go. The movie Willy Wonka had the golden ticket, which might very well reference the free pass to the quote, underground bases, all that. What do you think is the possibility if these elite do indeed go in the underground bases, which are fortresses, and I know there's ancient underground bases, ancient underground cities, pockmarked all over the world. What are the chances of these elite going underground with this golden ticket, surviving a major earth change?
I can't say because I don't know all of the factors involved. It would be highly situational. I just couldn't predict. And here's the thing, neither can they.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be luck of the draw. And even were they to survive a huge, major earth change, let's say any given member of the Bush family, let's say they go down into a deep, 3 mile deep underground bunker, or 20 mile deep, just high-tech, sci-fi-like, all hell breaks loose, and they come back topside, and they've got 200 bodyguards with, you know, automatic weapons and so forth. Once they run out of ammunition, what next? What next? Do they know how to start fires with sticks? I don't think so.
I don't think so. You're on record as saying that there's no evidence for Dulce in New Mexico, correct?
Well, there's a town of Dulce.
Oh, yeah, you know what I'm saying.
And I believe that the story as put forth by Phil Schneider, most
right.
notably,
right.
is disinformation.
Gotcha.
Let me qualify disinformation. Even in the word disinformation, there's the word information, but preceded by the prefix dis. So, even in disinformation, there's true information. So, part of this apocryphal Dulce story is true. Number one, there is a town of Dulce. Number two, strange things have happened in and around Dulce. But you know what? Strange things happen in and around this whole planet.
Everywhere.
You just have to open your eyes and start being observant. And if you don't notice strange things, then you're just not very conscious. But beyond that, there certainly are underground bases, including secret underground bases. There are underground bases in New Mexico. There are underground facilities in northern New Mexico. There are many UFOs that are seen in New Mexico. I have seen UFOs in New Mexico. But you don't necessarily get the Dulce story, the apocryphal Dulce story, as told when you mix all of those elements together. What I will say is that elements of what Phil Schneider said are undisputably true. There are underground bases. There are big underground bases. There are technologically sophisticated underground bases. There are underground bases in New Mexico. All of the evidence that I've seen strongly suggests that there are extraterrestrial beings, and some of them are here on Earth, etc., etc. Does all of that necessarily mean that everything that Phil Schneider said is true? No, not necessarily. In fact, he's dead, so no one can question what he said, least of all me. And as far as Krista Tilton came out with some of the earlier versions of that, even before Phil Schneider.
Mm-hmm.
was going around. Krista Tilton was going around saying that she had been abducted and taken to a secret underground joint United States military, joint extraterrestrial gray, deep beneath Dulce, New Mexico. That was back in the 1980s already, mid-1980s, I believe. I talked to Krista a couple of times, and she ended up telling me that she couldn't be sure that she was at Dulce, New Mexico, but that she was told the name of the place where she was Dulce. Do you understand the distinction?
Yes, indeed, yeah.
Dulce itself is a very common Spanish word that means sweet. Dulce just means sweet. It's one of the most common words in the Spanish language. So when she was taken to a place called Dulce, and she asked, "Where am I?" And they said, "You're at Dulce." They were just telling her, "You're at Sweet." It's meaningless. This place is called Sweet. In Spanish, it's meaningless. It's meaningless. So you could say it's sweet disinformation.
Ah, excellent. We're going to wrap up there for today. Thank you so much. It's a joy to talk with you. It's been quite a while since I first encountered you. You're a gentleman, and I really appreciate that. Do check out Dr. Sauder's books on our blog, deprogrammedradio.blogspot.com, or it's on the top of the mothership, John Tudor's big radio station there at the top right. And we thank you and wish you well, sir. I hope you take care of yourself.
Thanks a lot, Jerry. I appreciate it.
Okay. Catch you later, okay? Bye-bye.
Sure thing.
Hello? Hello?
Oui. Hello, bonjour, Mr. Woodward.
Pierre.
How are you today?
Ah, ça va. Bien?
Wonderful. I got your email. And it was encrypted, read it for me, please, real quick.
Certainly. This is the one from Dr. Sauder. It says, just after we finished, a massive lightning bolt struck the hostel where I live and fried the internet modem. I actually heard the electrical snap in my room. It was a huge electrical discharge. It was like an artillery shell hit the place. Bang.
This kind of thing, it happens very often in your line of work. You will find out. The good thing is they probably gave you a break for some reason. But there is
very nice
a lightning machine. But the chances of this happening more than once in the same film is not very...
Science news, alternative history, suppressed views and opinions, activism and esoterica are all here on Deprogrammed Radio.
Bye-bye.
Sure thing.